Welcome to Something Came From Baltimore. I am your host, Tom Galker. And before we get into the show, it's a great opportunity to chat about the podcast. Please subscribe, comment, and share with five people, your friends, who love music as much as you do. We want you all to be a part of that Be More Music scene. Today, on Something Came From Baltimore, we chat with saxophonist Dave McMurray. Dave got his big break with the funk band Was Not Was, with future superstar producer Don Was. Don Was is now the president of Blue Note Label, and that is where you'll find the latest Dave McMurray recording, Grateful Deadication. And you guessed it, it's not a cover record of the Grateful Dead band as much as a reinterpretation via jazz expression and improvisation. The story goes that in 2019, Dave McMurray finally met and played with Grateful Dead's Bob Weir, and got the Grateful Dead bug and the interest to plow through the Dead's catalog to get 10 recordings, and you get a summer feel-good jam band album. In this interview, we're going to find out if he was drinking with me in a late-night hotel in St. Petersburg in 1990. And we're also going to get more information on the lead-off single, Loser. How did he get Bettye LaVette on vocals and Bob Weir to play on the track? Let's sample Loser from the album Grateful Deadication.
I'm asking for is 10 gold dollars that I could pay you back with just one good hand. You can look all around the whole wide world over, but I bet never find another honest man. Last fair deal in the country.
Zoom, Dave McMurray, welcome to Something Came From Baltimore.
Hey, it's great to talk to you, man.
I want to put you back in the Wayback Machine. It's 1990. Okay, so you were with Was Not Was, and you were just touring on the Are You Okay album. You were invited to Camelot Music's convention in St. Petersburg. I was a Camelot Music record store manager.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, you guys played. And then, like, stayed around. The Was brothers may have left, but most of the band members stayed around for the whole weekend. There was a time that I was in the hotel room with Sweet Pea and Sir Harry Bowens. And I talked to Sir Harry. He was trying to hook up with some girl. And I asked him if he was the lead singer in Frank Zappa's You Are What You Is. He was all over that album. And he said, yeah. And then Sweet Pea was the adult in the room and kept on telling us to keep it down so we didn't get booted out. He had fingernails that were pointy. Like they
Sweet Pea.
Yeah. They were very scary.
Yeah, well, Sweet Pea, we used to call him like pimp nails, because he would be filing them and polishing them and keeping them nice every day. Nails were immaculate.
you were drawn to him. You couldn't stop looking at him.
he was definitely a character from the first day I met him. That's how he was.
Do you think you were in that hotel room with us, or does that not ring a bell?
I'm not sure, because I would usually be hanging anywhere it was some place to hang. I would be hanging. I would be surprised if I wasn't in that room.
Yeah, it was the band minus the two guys, the Was Not Was guys.
Well, I had to be there.
Yeah, you had to be there. But, you know, I was loaded. I remember that part. You guys
I remember Camelot Music, though. I do remember Camelot Music, that situation.
Yeah. Oh, okay. So yeah, so I was a Camelot Music store manager at that time. You guys were fantastic. And it was the Are You Okay album that you guys were promoting. You said you just got off of the 1989 Club MTV Music Tour.
Oh, yeah.
And you guys made it very clear that you were the only ones that weren't lip syncing. That means Paula Abdul, Information Society, Milli Vanilli, Tone Loc, and Lisa were probably using some tracks.
They definitely were using tracks. But Tone Loc, he was live himself. I mean, as far as his vocal, everything he did was live. But like Milli Vanilli, a lot of, you know, their vocals were on tape, of course.
Yeah.
You know, and it became more obvious. And the weird part about it is the audience could care less about it because they sounded like the record. So that's all the audience needs to hear. And they were very entertaining. If you were looking at them, they were entertaining.
What was it like growing up in Detroit? You're at a point where, you know, you had Parliament Funkadelic, all that Motown, Iggy Pop and the Stooges, and then the decline of the city, really. Just, you know, you had 2 million people living there. During that time period, what was it like as a musician or a fan of music?
As crazy as it got, music was kind of flourishing because it was lots of musicians. There was lots of desperation music going on. So, I mean, and growing up in Detroit, it was a cool thing as far as music because it had such a diverse music going on, you know. So any kind of music that I could wanted to hear, I would hear it. If I didn't want to hear it, I'd hear it. And you had great combinations of music. So I remember looking at a sign in Ann Arbor, and it had like a festival with like MC5 and Pharoah Sanders and Sun Ra. I'm like, what kind of what is that? You know, how could that, all that music work together? But that's kind of what was going on in Detroit. It was like a big melting pot of music. So it was lots of things going on. Not a lot of money flourishing. That's for sure. You know, it wasn't a lot of money going on, but it was lots of music going on everywhere. So it was a good point for me to learn music because I was hanging every circuit, which was my thing. You know, I like any music I heard on the radio, I would try to hear myself as a saxophone player in it. So if it was like rock music, I'd play it. And, you know, I'd try to imagine what I would play. If it was blues, I'd try to imagine what I would play, you know, everything. So it was a great place, you know, to be far as music.
Being in the band of Was Not Was and now Don Was is running Blue Note Records. Did you ever look at him at the 1980s when you're working with him or when you're in the 1990s and say, wow, he's going to go somewhere. Like he's going to be running.
He was the most, I met him in the 80s. And when I met him, he was at the time, one of the guys that was in my band, he did a session with him and he came back and he said, Dave, I did a session, a new wave session. That's what he called it. I was like, what? Really? He's like, yeah. He says, I think the guy's going to call you. His name's Don Woods. And I was like, well, okay. I had heard a little bit about him because he also played jazz. But when I met him, it was the craziest situation because Don Was at that time. The session started at midnight. And so, you know, which was really different at the time. And then when he was playing me the music, it was the first album. He really only played me bass lines and loops. So he would just say solo. He says, play right here. And then he meant like not normal playing. I mean, you know, like he knew what I did. So he's like, nah, play whatever you feel. Don't feel like you gotta, you know, play commercial or something. So ended up, we played all night and it was a great session, but I didn't even know really what the music sounded like. I just heard what I play. And months later, when I heard it, it was the craziest music ever. I mean, because it had all these soul vocals. And then his idea was that when I met him, he said, well, it's going to be just like if a funk band, if like Elvin Jones and Joe Henderson was playing in a funk band, you know, like a Parliament band, and all mixed together, you know, so it'd be like new wave and dance music. And I was looking at him like, okay, this is the craziest idea in the world. I like it. I'm the right person to be here. But when you're looking at him, I knew he had something going on because everything he did was totally different. Every edit he did, every musical thing he did, it was a odd combination because he dug dance music like I did, but he dug all, you know, avant-garde jazz. He could play standards. You know, he had kind of this big eclectic thing, and you knew something was going to happen. You know, and we remained friends. I met him in the 80s, and then we remained friends all these years, you know, like great friends. You know?
Let's sample a track from 1983 Was Not Was recording from Born to Laugh at Tornadoes. It's Man versus the Empire Brain Building.
Man versus nature, man versus woman, and man versus the Empire Brain Building.
Man versus woman, and man versus the Empire Brain Building.
You have this album, tribute to the Grateful Dead, called The Grateful Deadication. It came out July 16, 2021. On Blue Note, but you really weren't a Grateful Dead fan until you met Bob Weir in 2019.
Yeah, I just knew about them. Of course, you know, I knew their hits and I knew the reputation that was with them and all of that. But that was it. I knew the songs, but I wasn't, you know, I didn't follow them, but I was always trying to figure it out. Like, what is it? I know they have hits, but this is more than that. This is bigger than that. But when I met it's funny, when I met Bob Weir and I knew that was what it was about, I still didn't really understand it, but I was a fan of it because I knew that they were fans of all the people I love. I knew that they were fans of Miles Davis. And when I saw Miles Davis open up for him at the Fillmore, I was like, this was years ago. I was like, what? Wow, that's crazy. You know, it's like, this is some music I got to investigate, but just music. But when I met him, when we played one of his songs, it was incredible what happened. And, you know, and I just watched the audience. It was like they were hypnotized. And the song, the music was hypnotizing. And I was like, that was what made me go, I got to investigate this for real. You know, besides seeing the fact that Brant and Marcellus played with him or Ornette Coleman. You know, when you see that, you go, wow, what makes them attracted to that? You know, the band attracted to them and them attracted to the band. So I just dived into it. You know,
they have, a couple albums, about 14 studio albums, and the live recordings are, you know, just so many of them. Maybe difficult to pick out the ones you want because you went with Grateful Dead hits, but not top 40 hits. In other words, a Deadhead would know these songs where, you know, other people wouldn't, like the 11th. That's not
right.
Doesn't get a lot of radio play. So you were able, I think you picked out like their career, a wide spectrum of music and represented that on this album.
Yeah, because they have so much material. So in looking at the songs, I would just kind of listen to songs and, you know, being a saxophone player, I knew I had to grab songs with the great intros and great melodies. So the first song I picked was Dark Star. And I just picked it. I heard it. I was like, oh, that intro. And then it is so melodic. I was like, let me just try this and see what happened. You know, see how it goes. It was the first one, and then I kind of went song by song. You know, I picked the next song and I go, okay, I need one like this. And then I just start listening to their studio albums, and then I start listening to live records, because they were all the live records would span for years, and they would actually change. The songs would, you know, change. They would change the beat and stuff. And that's just totally intriguing to me. So I picked songs that had the melody that I knew people would not necessarily, not like that hit song, but they had a strong melody that if they heard it instrumentally, they would know what it was.
I think that's one of the key points of why this album really works well, is that you took the essence of each song and did what they did, which is kind of create, you know, something a little different. One of the songs that I wanted to talk about was Dark Star. I think your interpretation was great. I think it's I hope it gets a lot of airplay, because anyone who's kind of a rock fan or a Dead fan or even a jazz fan, you know, will appreciate this whole full album.
Thank you.
before we get into the interview, we played a segment of Loser with what you had the video for with Bettye LaVette, and you have Bob Weir. If we've already played that before we get into the interview, but do you have any thoughts on that? How did you get Bob in there, and how'd you get Bettye? And
I knew I was going to have at least one vocalist on there. And, you know, my thought was it was going to be Sweet Pea. All while I was recording the instrumentals, I was trying to think of an instrumental. You know, Sweet Pea passed unexpected. Oh, he was actually coming to Detroit last June. He was on his way and we were going to record. But he passed before that. It really kind of, it freaked me out. It freaked everybody out. And so that's just, I was like, well, what am I going to do? Like, who will I get? So I just started thinking of vocalists to fit into the situation. And so all kinds of different books, you know, different types of sounds and stuff like that. And I was talking about it to my manager, and then she mentioned Bettye LaVette. And I was like, wow, that could be good right there. You know, I was like, let's think about that. And so she was talking to Darren about it. And then he said, hey, you know Bettye LaVette? And it was like, whoa, wait a minute. That's two different people and two different, you know, completely different. He mentioned Bettye LaVette too. I was like, I think that's a good sign. I had no contact with Bettye LaVette at all. She's from Detroit, but I didn't know her at all. But I had friends that played with her. So we just said, well, let's see about how, if we can make that happen. You know, how to make it happen. To her, her first thing was, what? The Grateful Dead? Like, why me? Like, what do I have to do with the Grateful Dead? You know, and I was like, nah, you just be perfect. You know, and she said, I said, well, let me listen to it. But when she did it, her interpretation of the lyric was incredible. It was more than I expected. It was different than I expected because she really got into the lyric. Once she found her space, she said, so she kept saying, what am I? What is it? She said, so I'm like Calamity Jane. That's what she put. That's what she said. I'm like Calamity Jane. I was like, yeah. And she's like, okay. And I think that was a motivation for her. And that's when she came up with that interpretation of it. And when she did that vocal, that's kind of led to Bob Weir. Cause I was, you know, I wanted to get Bob Weir, you know, of course that would be a dream to get, you know, to get Bob Weir on it. Pretty much when he heard her vocal, that made that happen. Cause he heard her vocal and was like, whoa, you know, I mean, just her interpretation of the lyric brought that on. It brought a whole new emotion. And so, I mean, it just kind of all came together. That was the last song we did. Running late, the paper number morning sky, it looks so phony. Dawn is breaking everywhere. Light a candle, curse the glare. Draw the curtains, I don't care, because it's sunrise.
Vocals of Herschel Boone for Touch of Grey. Herschel Boone, I was just looking at it. Your past, like, crossed with him just as equally as long as Don was. And
yeah, and
just by hearing his voice, he sounded very young, you know, to me. I love the interpretation of Touch of Grey. I'll be honest with you, in 1987, when that came out, I was never a fan of that song because I didn't relate to it. But now, as a
right.
As an older person, you know, songs like Everything Must Change and Touch of Grey make a lot more sense to me. The arrangement is fantastic. I'm going to play the Touch of Grey vocal, you know, for the audience. I smell a hit on this one, and I hope it's a big hit for you. You've worked with Herschel for years, off and on.
Oh, yeah, for years. See, I mean, he is such a great interpreter of songs. I mean, just a great vocalist in general and writer. He's like one of those guys with perfect pitch. I met him when he was probably 16 or something like that. And he was just an incredible talent then, you know, far ahead of what his voice sounds like. So I just tried to come up with an arrangement that I thought he was going to dig. I knew he was going to dig the lyrics because of the irony in the lyrics. But he had not, when I told him Touch of Grey, he didn't think of the original with the video and all that. He didn't even think of that. Because I just sent him my demo. And when he heard it, And then I gave him something with the lyrics. He was like, Dave, yeah, I can do this. And so he and we went back, you know, we went about doing it. So we took a few weeks and knocked the vocal out, but he had not heard the original yet, which was hilarious to me, you know, because he just didn't put it together. And once we got it all down, I said, now I want to send you the original. And, you know, he had heard the original because at that point you couldn't get away from it. It was like one of the first MTV darling songs, you know, because of that video. And when he heard it, he just cracked up and he's like, "Yay! I didn't even think of that being the song." that song, the original, is such a happy song, and the lyrics aren't necessarily so happy. You know, they're kind of dark lyrics. But when he sang it, I loved his interpretation because he actually had a little hope in his interpretation, his hope for it, because, you know, like, we're gonna make it, you know, at the end. I was like, now that's interesting, you interpreted it kind of differently than the original. You know, the original music was so happy, but it was pretty dark. You know, he's like, "Oh, you're gonna get a touch," you know, every silver line, and he tells her, it has a touch of gray, like, you're gonna feel it too. So I love his interpretation of it.
Here is the sample of the original 1987 single from the Grateful Dead called Touch of Grey from the In the Dark album.
And the album starts off with another like major score on this album, which is Fire on the Mountain, which to me is a great summer song. We're getting into fall. The people who are listening to this album is going to have to think of summer when they're playing it in their car while going to work, because it's a really good feel-good version of Fire on the Mountain.
Well, one of those, as soon as I heard it, I immediately loved groove. I just loved it. So I was just like, well, I kind of want to do it the same, but I just add a little bit of something. But it ended up, when we did it, everybody liked it. I mean, you know, people I would play for who didn't know anything about the Grateful Dead, they go, "So you're doing the Grateful Dead? Well, what about this one?" They say, "Well, this one, you wrote this one, right?" I was like, "No, I didn't write that. That's Fire on the Mountain. It's one of their records." "What? This doesn't sound like it." I was like, "Actually, it does. It's like, we got just a little heavier beat on it, but it's really the song." But what made me really happy about it, because one day I was going into a grocery store and I'm playing my version, you know, just listening to it, trying to fix, you know, make sure, see what I'm going to do to it next. And I had the windows up and I'm sitting in the car before I get out listening to it. And so when I got out, I got out of the car, and then the guy who was next to me, he said, you need a basket? I was like, yeah. And then he gave me the basket. He said, anything for a guy playing Fire on the Mountain. I said, oh, you heard that? And he said, yeah, I love the Grateful Dead. I was like, wow, okay, you recognized it. And outside of the car, that's a good sign. You know, it's like, okay, I must be going in the right direction. Because I wanted people to really know what the song is, you know, instrumentally. I want you to know what it is, you know, and he grabbed it from outside the car. So I was like, good.
Dave, thank you very much. Well, I can't wait for you to be in the neighborhood. It's really weird. You launched this in the spring because I could see you do a lot of festivals. A lot of people would have ran out, you know, to hear you.
Right.
There's nothing saying you can't drag this one until next year because when it comes to recordings, I don't really care when it was released, like if it's a new release or not, because people are so disconnected about time right now. It doesn't really matter. So you have all next year to book those outdoors and really blow people away with this album. It's going to be a lot of fun.
Yes, that's definitely the plan, because I've been working like just all the club scene now, and it's been going really good because for me, it's a different audience because people are, they know it's jazz, but they stand up. And they stand up and they dance, and the crazier I play, the more they dance, which is very good.
That's awesome.
The gigs have been, so it's been a great experience. So I'm hoping to carry it over. So, you know, going down south in a couple of weeks, and then, you know, going out west, and then hopefully I keep it moving to next year.
Book all that stuff because I think people are going to go crazy. So I thank you very much for joining me today on Something Came from Baltimore. The album's called Grateful Deadication. It's by Dave McMurray, and it's on Blue Note. Came out July 16. It's a summer album that deserves to be played year-round, so I recommend everyone who's listening to check it out.
Thanks a lot, too, man. And I got to get to Baltimore to play.
Definitely. Yeah, we got a couple venues for you.
Thank you, Dave McMurray, for joining me today on Something Came from Baltimore. Friends, please subscribe to the podcast. You share it with 5 friends who love music just as much as you do. We want you all to be a part of that Be More Music scene.